Servus everyone and welcome to another video. If you followed along so far, you know that this is the third episode in a series about the Asus P55 T2 P4 motherboard. If you want to know a bit of history, you can watch the first video. In the second video, I put together a build and install Windows 98. Today I will upgrade the cache from 256 to 512 kilobytes. We will also have a look at the cacheable memory area. But before we get into this, I think it's important to have a look at what cache is and why it exists. Here is an Intel Pentium with 200 MHz. It will be responsible to execute instructions in our fictitious system. But in order to do this, we need to provide data to the CPU. Let's add a hard drive with data that can be sent to the Pentium for processing. Now we just need to switch on the system and see how it performs. The performance is very low, and the hard drive is at 100% usage. Why do we not get the performance we expect from the system? Maybe we can figure out where the problem is. Let's assume the Pentium can execute one instruction per cycle, for instance adding two numbers. Since it is clocked at 200 MHz, we have to convert it into hertz, or cycles per second. The Pentium can execute 200 million instructions per second. Let's break it further down and calculate how much time the CPU needs to execute one instruction. We start with 200 million instructions per second. These are 200,000 instructions per millisecond, or 200 instructions per microsecond. If we divide it by another 1,000, we get 0.2 instructions per nanosecond. Multiply both sides by 5, and we get 1 instruction every 5 nanoseconds. So, our CPU needs only 5 nanoseconds to complete one operation. And how long does it take to retrieve data from a hard drive? Unfortunately, the hard drive needs thousands of nanoseconds to just locate the data on the magnetic platters. This seek time for modern hard drives is around 9 milliseconds, or 9,000 nanoseconds. After that, the drive still needs more time to read and transfer the data to the CPU. No wonder the hard drive is helplessly overwhelmed by the CPU's request for data. We need another data storage system that sits in between the processor and the main storage, and that can provide enough data to our CPU on time. Here is some memory. Memory does not have any moving parts. The memory modules consist of several memory chips that hold the data once it was requested by a CPU. If the data is required again, we can skip the slow hard drive and receive it directly from the memory. Great! Let's install the modules and see what happens. This is much better. The hard drive calmed down quite a bit. But still the computer is not working at its best performance. Seems like we still cannot provide enough data to the CPU on time. Although memory is much faster compared to a hard drive, it still takes around 100 nanoseconds to access and retrieve the data. Still not good enough. Our CPU can execute instructions much faster. We still need more speed. And finally we can talk about cache. Cache goes between the CPU and the memory. Most cache today is built into the CPU directly. But when the Asus P55 T2 P4 was released, CPUs only had a small amount of cache on the die. The level 2 cache was placed on the motherboard. Although cache is much faster than regular memory, it requires a lot more physical space and is more expensive to produce. In order to reduce cost, some motherboards had either none or limited cache available out of the box. Through expansion slots, the user could upgrade the cache later. Let's connect the cache into the system. Here we go. We finally made our system perform to our expectations. Some cache is as fast as the CPU itself. The CPU keeps only recently accessed data in the cache in case it requires it again in the future. Instead of going to the slower memory or hard drive, it can just use the data from the cache. The Pentium has 16 kilobytes of L1 cache and 256 kilobytes of L2 cache, which is directly soldered onto the motherboard. I'll run a few benchmarks and see if the performance or any other parameters are changing. The baseline will be the base configuration. Next, I will upgrade the motherboard to 512 kilobytes of L2 cache. And finally, a TAGRAM upgrade will ensure that we can cache more than only 64 megabytes of system memory. Let's start with a baseline. Here we can see our 256 kilobytes of L2 cache, 2x8 kilobytes of L1 cache, but also only 64 megabytes in the cacheable area. Here is a visualization of the cache and the system memory throughput. we can clearly see that the performance drops at 8 kilobytes, which is the size of the L1 cache, and 256 kilobytes, which is the size of the level 2 cache. Have a look at the memory speeds. The system memory has a throughput of 62 megabytes per second. The L2 cache is twice as fast as the system memory, and the L1 cache is 6 times faster than the system memory. Unfortunately, we cannot upgrade the L1 cache, but we can double the L2 cache. This is a cache expansion module, a so-called COAST module. It will increase the total L2 cache size from 256 to 512 kilobytes. We need to install this module in the corresponding expansion slot on the motherboard. After that, we just have to set a jumper to configure the board for the larger cache size. Now we can run the tests again. Nothing has changed for the L1 performance drop. However, the L2 performance drops now at 512 kilobytes instead of 256 kilobytes. The cache upgrade seems to be working. Unfortunately, we still have the limit of 64 megabytes of cacheable system memory. To rectify this, we need to install a tag RAM upgrade. The motherboard manual gives details about the correct specification and installation of the additional components. Furthermore, another jumper needs to be set to configure the board correctly. Here are two types of SRAM chips I had available. Follow the manual for the correct specification of the chips. The lower one does not meet the specifications. If you search the internet for the numbers printed on the chips, you usually get the data sheets with the exact specifications. This is how I looked up what chip I had to install. Set the jumper and install the chip in the motherboard. Pay attention to the correct orientation by matching the notch on the socket to the notch on the chip. The cache performance is unaffected by the tag RAM. However, it is now possible to cache the entire system memory. We do no longer have the 64 MB cacheable memory area limit. And that is it for the upgrades. Now we can have a look if and by how much the performance increased. The benchmarks I have used to measure the differences between the upgrades show anything between no improvements to a small performance increase of around 4%. The good news is that throughout all the tests, the performance was usually higher with the upgraded L2 cache and the tag RAM. My assumption is that the performance increase will be noticeable depending on the type of work done by the entire system. In some scenarios, you won't be able to tell the difference between no upgrades and the fully upgraded system. The CPU performance benchmark of CPU-Z shows the highest gains when upgrading from 256 to 512 kilobytes of L2 cache. Here are some productivity benchmarks. Again, the increase in performance is not present in all types of workloads. However, if you look at the memory benchmarks, you can see a noticeable performance increase of around 27%. The average uplift of the entire system is around 12%. If you have the possibility to upgrade both the L2 cache and the tag RAM to eliminate the non-cacheable memory area, I would strongly recommend it. There may be workloads that will benefit a lot from those upgrades, or worse, some workloads may be slowed down significantly and make your retro PC feel slow. And that's it for this one. In the next video, I will try to get USB to work under Windows 98. I'm looking forward to see you in the next video.